two pipeline stages, fetch and decode linear combined. So moving on, today we'll look at the remaining pipe stages, how they work. So the third stage is the issue, instruction issue stage. And there are three issue queues that you mentioned last time, integer queue, floating point queue, and the address queue. Three issue queue selection logics work in parallel because these are independent queues. Integer and floating point queue issue logics are similar. So I'll not go into details of this because we discussed it in discussing breakup logic and everything. They look very similar. So here's a summary of the integer issue queue logic. The integer queue contains 16 entries, which can hold at most 16 instructions. And it's a collapsible content addressable memory. So this one also we discussed last time. This allows you to compare a value with all the entries and select certain entries. So this is needed for comparing the register identifiers to wake up instructions. And essentially, it searches for ready to issue instructions among these 16. Issue at most two instructions to two ALUs, and it can issue back-to-back integer instructions. So that this also discussed. This is possible because you can pick up the values from the bypass network. The address queue is slightly more complicated. It's not a collapsible CAM. So this one is collapsible because you can issue instructions out of the program order. So which means whichever gets ready will issue. And that will create all holes in between the queues, the queue entries. So to free up the slots towards the tail of the queue, you have to collapse it so that the holes can move to one end where you can keep allocating. This one is a FIFO CAM, meaning that instructions cannot issue out of order. They will only issue in order. And when a load or a store is issued, the address is still not known. So we have also discussed this problem earlier, that what kind of complications that can arise because of this. So to simplify matters, what R10K does is that it issues loads and stores in order. So which is why this is a FIFO CAM. It's not a collapsible CAM. So that's the address queue. There are a couple of more logics associated with the address queue. So there is a load retry unit. So let's try to first understand what may require retrying a load instruction. First of all is a data cache miss. That is, you issue a load instruction that misses the data cache. Okay, so what you essentially have to do is that you launch a miss request so that the data comes back from somewhere. Higher levels in the hierarchy. And when the data comes back, the load will have to be retried, possibly. So reissue the load, and hopefully this time it will hit the cache. And there is a memory address, and the second situation where you may want to retry a load is a memory address conflict. So this one we haven't discussed when discussing caches, so let me try to explain it now. So what happens is that suppose you have a cache miss. So what you need to do is you issue the miss request to the next level of the memory hierarchy, and also you start selecting a replacement candidate. So it is when the data comes back, where it will sit in the cache. Okay. Now the problem arises if while that miss is outstanding, you get one more request to the same cache index, which also misses the cache. Right? So now, of course, you can say that, well, I can continue doing my replacement, running my replacement policy without the already selected replacement candidate. So essentially, if I have a four-way cache, I have four candidates to select for replacement. So I'm saying that the first cache miss already selected this one for replacement. Okay. And before this one comes back, there is another request that goes to the same cache index. Okay. So what are the options do I have? Well, I can say that you cannot use this one for replacement anymore, because this one is already kind of reserved. Right? You can only select one from these three. So instead of doing that, what R10K does is that it disallows the second request. Okay. The second request will have to be retried once this miss results, which essentially says that you can have at most one cache miss request per cache set outstanding at any point in time. Right? So that's one example of memory address conflict. Okay. The second example is easier, where suppose you have a load instruction which missed in the cache, and the request has gone out to be fetched, and you get a second load instruction which maps to the same cache block that has just missed, right? Because a cache block is several bytes, right? So I can have two load instructions. So if this is my cache block, I can have one load instruction loading from here, right? Another load instruction that is loading from here. So these are maybe 4 bytes each, whereas I have a cache block of say 32 bytes. And then suppose that this one happens first, this one goes second. Right? So when this miss happens, you have already sent a request for this cache block. Okay. So of course then it doesn't make any sense when you have this miss to send a request again. Right? So in this case, what we'll do is that we'll reject this load and we'll retry it with the cache block conflict. So that's another example of a memory address conflict. It's not exactly a conflict, it's essentially a request mapping to a cache block which is already outstanding. So for both of these, you retry the load later. So there are two 16x16 matrices that track address dependence information. And rows and columns are address queue entries because there are 16 entries in these queues. The first matrix avoids unnecessary thrashing by allocating one way in a set to the oldest conflicting address queue entry. So it makes sure that the oldest entry always makes progress. By allocating a replacement candidate. Okay. The second matrix records load store dependency at 64-bit drain and carries out load forwarding. So this is what we discussed earlier, that if a load overlaps with an already outstanding store, then the load can take the value from the store if it overlaps completely. Okay. So that's what is tracked by the second matrix. A returning refill, so a refill is essentially a message that happens in response to a cache miss. So you send a cache miss request, eventually the refill comes back to the cache. So returning refill snoops the address queue and wakes up all matching instructions. So there may be multiple load store instructions waiting for this particular cache block. When that comes back, it will essentially compare the cache block address with all the pending addresses, the 16 entries in the queue. And anybody that matches, we'll retry through a dedicated cache port. So this port allows one retry per cycle, so we'll retry one after another from subsequent cycles. So that's pretty much the address queue logic. So as you can see, there are two simplifying factors that help the design. One is that the address queue is a FIFO queue. So you issue load store in order. That takes care of your loads bypassing a store to the same address and getting a wrong value that we discussed earlier in the class. And the second simplification is this one, that it allows only at most one cache miss per cache index at any point in time.
How do these matrices work? So 16x16 matrix,
yeah.
And the first matrix avoids.
So this matrix essentially keeps track of your index conflicts, this one. And if there are two address queue entries that require the same cache index, it will make sure that the oldest entry gets a way result. So that we make progress. Right? If you did the other way, if we allocate the younger entry to this particular way, the older entry may actually replace it before the younger entry comes back. So they keep on replacing each other. It doesn't make any sense. Because remember that between a refill and a retry, there is a window of time where the refill block may actually get replaced, and the retry may generate one more cache miss. And you definitely won't worry about that. Because this may lead to a live block. It will keep on happening forever. If there are two entries that are continuously thrashing each other. The problem is more severe in MIPS RTMK because their L1 caches are 2 ways instead of 0. So that makes it very vulnerable to these problems, these thrashing problems. If you have more ways, then it becomes much easier. Okay? So any more questions? Address queue. Okay, so Just a small point about the dependent instructions that take value from a load. Okay, so essentially you're talking about a situation where you have a load instruction, may look like this. And then you have, let's say, an add instruction that consumes dollar two. So we're talking about, so these are dependent instructions on the load. So the load state two cycles to execute. During the first cycle, the address is computed. During the second cycle, the data TLB and the data cache are accessed. So essentially, if you look at the pipeline of the load instruction, it will look like this. So first stage is fetch. Second stage is decode rename. Then it issues. Then it, I'll call it address generation. And then the memory stage. And then it will commit sometime later. All right. So this is roughly what this is roughly what your load pipeline will look like. Okay. So ideally, I want to issue an instruction dependent on the load so that the instruction can pick up the load value from the bypass just in time. Okay. So if you look at this instruction, add instruction, I would basically want my add instruction's execution stage to be positioned here, okay, so that it can pick up the value from the bypass from the memory state. Okay. So moving backward, what it means is that I must issue the instruction here, right? Because for add instruction, this is essentially the execution stage, okay, right? And then decode, rename, etc. So assume that a load issues in cycle zero. So this is cycle zero. Okay. So time moves in this direction. Compute address in address one, cycle one. So this is cycle one. Okay. And looks up cache in cycle two. So this is cycle two. Alright? And remember that this particular stage may take several cycles depending on whether I hit or miss in the cache. Alright? What I'm showing here is the best possible scenario that I hit in the cache actually. Okay. So I want to issue the dependent in cycle two, as I've shown here, so that this can pick up the value in the execution stage. So that it can pick up the load value just before executing in cycle 3. So this is cycle 3. So this commit may not be exactly here, maybe farther away. So the load looks up cache in parallel with issuing of the dependent, right? So this is, that is what is happening in this cycle. While the load is looking up cache, I am issuing the dependent. Okay. So what am I assuming here? Essentially, what I'm assuming is that this load is going to hit the cache, which is why I'm issuing it here. Otherwise, I wouldn't have issued it here. The issue would be delayed. Okay. So this is essentially a speculation. We have talked about this earlier. So dependent on the issued event before, it is known whether the load will hit in the cache. This is called load hit speculation. And essentially, what may happen is that your speculation may go wrong in cases when the load misses the cache. Okay. Now, you might ask, what is the big deal? Anyway, we are going to lose a large number of cycles since the load has missed the cache. Okay. What is important is that instead of issuing this load, if I knew this load is actually going to miss the cache, instead of issuing this load in this cycle, I could have issued an independent instruction, which wouldn't have wasted this cycle. Because essentially, I'm now wasting this particular cycle, this particular issue slot. Okay. All right, so that's where I start losing performance because of this type of misspeculation. Okay. The good news is that this particular speculation is correct most of the time, because hit rate is normally high in caches. So for most programs, you can easily assume that your hit rate will be in excess of 90%. So with a likelihood of 0.9, more than 0.9, I would be assured that this will not miss a cache. So, all right, is it clear to everybody? Okay. This particular speculation. Now, we'll look at Pentium 4 very soon, probably next week sometime. You'll find that it has actually multiple issue stages. Because Pentium 4 pipeline is much deeper than this pipeline. Okay. So now you can imagine what's going to happen here. These dependent issues here, all right? And it'll go through several pipe stages before it goes to execution. And based on that decision, dependent of that particular instruction, so for example, there could be another instruction here which consumes $3. I'll assume that this add will actually pick up the value in the right time, and assuming that I will issue this instruction also, before even knowing anything, what is going to happen, this, happen to this instruction. So here we are talking about wasting just one issue slot. Okay. There you find that this particular speculation can lead to several lost cycles. Okay. You know this, all right? So anyway, when you come to that point, we will see that more detail. Any questions for this? Okay. Sorted KSS doesn't do anything actually to improve this particular speculation accuracy. It just always assumes, blindly assumes that the load will beat over time. You could actually have, you could actually have a predictor here which could learn the behavior of a load. For example, it's known that certain load instructions miss heavily in the cache. Okay. They are biased towards missing the cache. Okay. So for those dependents, you could actually not do this speculation. Okay. So, but anyway, RTNK doesn't really do anything of that sort. We'll look at one such predictor. We'll discuss the alpha processor next. Okay, all right. So this is a summary of the functional units. Sorry, the slide is very dense. So right after an instruction is issued, it reads the source operands dictated by the physical register number from the register file. And from stage 4 onward, the instructions execute. So let me see. So in this example, I skipped one stage here just for the sake of explanation. So actually, we have one more stage in between. So we could rename the issue, the register fetch, and then you need execute. So this is essentially the stage 4, right? Okay. So stage 1, stage 2, oh sorry. So RF and execute is where we fused together, stage 4, okay. So this is actually correct, okay. Okay, so there are two ALUs. Branch and shift can execute on ALU 1. Multiply, divide can execute on ALU 2. All other instructions can execute on any of the two ALUs, all right? So ALU 1 is responsible for triggering rollback in case of branch misprediction, I guess, because it executes the branch instructions. And misprediction recovery, we already talked about this, marks all instructions after the branch is squashed, restores the register map from correct branch stack entry, sends the fetch PC to the correct target. Okay. There are four floating point units, one dedicated for floating point multiply, one for floating point divide, one for floating point square root. Most of the other instructions execute the remaining floating point. And there is the load store unit has two address calculators. So result of one is actually selected, so I'll soon explain it, why this is done in this way. Data TLB is fully associated with 64 entries and translates 44-bit virtual address to 40-bit physical address. Physical address is used to match data cache tags, which is virtually indexed and physically tagged. Okay, so your pipeline looks like this. Issue, register, fetch. Then execute, or what I call an address generation stage here. With memory and then commit sometimes. All right, so any question on this? So can somebody guess why this is done like this? There are two address generation units, but you select only one of them. So why should I have two then? 64-bit processor. Under what circumstances you would actually do that? It's clear that you are doing something on two ALUs, and the reason why you're doing using both the ALUs is because you probably don't know which one will produce the correct result when you start the computer. At a later point, you get to know which one should be selected. So essentially, you are doing some kind of a speculation here. What could that be?
Program counter ALU.
This ALU, these two ALUs always receive load store instructions. So there is no ambiguity here. Program counters get routed to this particular ALU for computing branch targets. Well, actually, branch targets are computed even earlier in the pipeline stage. We discussed that. In the second stage, you said we compute branch targets. That is a separate issue. this ALU only computes the comparison outcome.
So the ALU is computing the effective address.
Effective address, right. So these two ALUs produce two addresses, one of which is correct.
It's
sorry?
One address calculated based on taken branch?
No, nothing like that. No, I first of all don't understand what you mean by that.
I mean the load is.
So I have an instruction, a load instruction.
Load instruction.
Right.
Effective address will be PC plus offset.
No. There's no PC here. We are mixing with branch target. This is a load effective address. So you'll have a base register, you'll have an offset. After the if else.
If else.
I could do that, but that's not what it's done here. Okay, so the answer is that MIPS RTK has two different formats of load instructions, which you probably haven't seen in your simulator. And this format is not decoded until the load reaches this point. So you send the instruction to both the ALUs. One ALU will assume one format and compute the address. Other ALU will assume the other format and compute the address. In parallel, you decode the format of the load instruction.
Okay, right?
And finally, you put a multiplexer, which will select one of these based on the outcome of the decoding. So let's see how many read ports and write ports are there in the register file. There are 7 read ports in integer files. So remember that we have 2 separate register files, one for integer instructions, one for integer values, one for floating point values, each of 64 entries. We discussed that last time. So what are these 7 read ports? So remember that we have 2 integer ALUs, right? We just discussed in the last slide. So for those, you require 2 read ports each, right? Because there will be 2 operands for each of these functions. That makes it 4. There are 2 read ports for the address generation ALU, so this one. Okay. So there are 2 ALUs, 2 address generation ALUs. Each of them may require 1 register. So that makes it 6, and one read port is shared between store, because store will require reading one register for the value that is trying to store. Okay. JR and JLR, they'll need to read one register to know the branch target, because these are indirect branches. Okay. And move to floating point register file. Okay. So these are your MTC instructions. Move to coprocessor, right? So that will require one port. So these 3 actually share a port, which means that there will be a scheduler, which will hopefully make a fair scheduling between these 3 types of instructions to give access to that particular port. Okay. So that makes it 7. So again, notice one interesting design trade-off here. You could ask, well, why didn't they have 9 reports? So then I could actually get rid of this particular sharing. Okay. The point is that these 3 types of instructions are very infrequent. Okay. So it doesn't make any sense to dedicate one port for them, because they will be very rarely used. Right? So they say that, well, even if I have one port, very rarely I'll have a cycle where 2 of these actually are contending for this port. Most of the time, this port will be given to the instruction, there will be only 1 instruction contending for this port. Okay. 3 write ports, 1 for each ALU. So these 2 ALUs are talking about. Address generation ALU doesn't need any write port, because it doesn't write to the register file. It just generates an address, which is used to look up the TLP and the cache. And 1 shared by load JL and JLR and move from 14.5. So these instructions would need to write the return address to a register. Right? And again, the same argument actually follows that these are more frequent instructions, ALU instructions. These are not so frequent, so you can share it. All right. And again, the second point is that rarely you have a cycle that would have two of these instructions ready and build content for the same value. We talked about a predicate bit last time. We talked about conditional move instructions, right? So there is a 64-bit predicate vector attached to the integer file needed for executing conditional move on zero instructions. So this is essentially a bit attached to each integer register, right? So of course, I mean, the way they implemented is that there's a separate 64-bit register which is treated as a vector, and ith bit corresponds to the ith predicate value, okay, which essentially says that whether register I is 0 or not. Okay, so that's what it means. So whenever you produce a value in register I, you also compute this particular predicate at the same time and set the corresponding bit. There are 5 read ports in the floating point file, so let's see what these are. 2 each for adder and multiplier, so they would require 2 operands to be read. And 1 shared between store and move. So why don't we need any read port for load instructions, floating point loads? Sorry?
Addresses.
Say again?
Addresses load.
Huh.
Addresses.
Huh.
Integer register would be.
Exactly, right. So the only thing that we need for a load instruction is an integer register, which is required to compute the address. Okay, address is an integer value. It doesn't have anything to do with the floating point register file. But it will require a write port. So that's what is mentioned here. So 3 write ports, 1 each for adder and multiplier, so these 2, and 1 shared between load and move. So here, these move instructions that we're talking about, what are these move instructions? Move from one floating point register to another. That's what we're talking about here. So move from the floating point file to the integer file, and this one is essentially move from integer file to the floating point. The floating point move instruction, that is, that moves from one floating point register to another floating point register, that execute on the remaining. On the remaining entry. So one for multiply, one for divide, one for square root, and add, subtract, move, and everything else, negate, etc., etc., would execute on the last entry. So floating point stores will require a floating point value.
So they would be also, so the address, same address generation would be stored?
Yes.
Same.
Yes, floating point and integer load store to share the same address generation. Yes. Okay, result write back. As soon as the instruction completes execution, the result is written back to the destination physical register. So as I just mentioned, no need to wait till retirement, since the renamer has guaranteed that this physical destination is associated with a unique instruction in the pipeline. Also, the results are launched on the bypass network. From the register file write ports to inputs of ALU, APU, and AGU. This guarantees that the dependents can be issued back to back and still they can receive the correct value. So, for example, here, right, if the load hits, this guy will pick up the value from the bypass only because you are doing this. Okay. So, as soon as the instruction completes, you launch the result on the bypass network. Okay. So, for example, here, right? I can issue these 2 instructions back to back. Okay, right? So if you look at the pipeline timing for these 2 instructions, so the first add instruction etc. And I want to position the second add instructions execute stage here so that you can pick it up from the bypass. So I'll be issuing it here. So essentially what it means is that on 2 consecutive cycles, I'll be issuing the 2 add instructions, one after another, without any bubble in between. right? And still, the second ad will get the value on time.
Okay.
So the second ad will actually read read R3 from register file here, which will be a wrong value, which will get overridden here from the right bus. Okay, so retirement or commit. Immediately, so this is the last phase of the instruction. Immediately after the instructions finish execution, they may not be able to leave the pipe. Okay. Because you have to guarantee in-order retirement, which is necessary for precise exception. Okay. When an instruction comes to the head of the active list, it can retire. Because it's a P4Q. So when you come to the head, you know that it's your turn to retire. R10K retires 4 instructions every cycle, so we discussed that last time, which is why your ROB, sorry, the active list is 4-way banked. So what does the retirement involve? It updates the branch predictor and frees the branch stack entry if it's a branch instruction. It moves the stored value from the address queue entry to the L1 data cache if it's a stored instruction. So remember that the stored values are not moved to the memory or the cache until the instruction retires, because you don't really know if the instruction will retire, okay, because there will be a branch before the stored instruction which may mispredict. And the store may not even retire for you. So this has an implication, which is that the your address queue entries must have a field to hold the value of the store. It frees the old destination physical register and updates the register for release. So this one we discussed last time. Frees the address queue entry if it's a load store. So remember that. So this is very interesting. An interior floating point instruction frees the issue queue entry immediately after it issues. Okay. But a load store instruction holds the address queue entry until it retires. Okay, right? So why is that? What is the difference actually? So what I'm saying is that this add instruction, for example, would free the issue queue entry right here as soon as it leaves the issue queue. Okay. But if it was a load instruction, it would not do that. It would hold the address queue entry until it commits. What's the reason for holding this so long?
It has to retry and it has to store the value for stores, which are...
Okay, so stores I again understand, but retries...
So load instructions, they can be retried...
Yeah, sure, so I can say that, well, those which miss the cache may free the entry once they complete execution.
Yeah.
Or their issue succeeds. But that's still earlier than commit. Commit is like, you're delaying it longer. What is the reason? Okay, so you don't know the answer actually, which is fair enough. So the reason why it is here is a purely multiprocessor reason. What may happen is that some other processor, so let's say you're loading from address X. Some other processor may modify address X. Okay. So what may have happened is that you have loaded a value from address X because the load has completed, but you haven't yet retired. Okay. Because you haven't yet moved to the head of the active list. So while you are sitting in the active list waiting to be retired, some other processor modifies address X.
Okay.
It's free to do that. So the question is, is it okay to retire this load without any concern? Because remember that this load must have loaded the previous value.
Okay.
The value won't reflect the value that has been produced by the other processor.
Okay.
So essentially, I have two processors, P1 and P2. This one had a load from address X. This one had a store to address X. This load happened before the store, but it retired after the store. So in certain situations, it's not correct to retire this load. You have to retry it even after that.
Okay,
right? So to catch that, you maintain this queue entry so that the other processor can actually probe when the store actually comes up in this processor. It will go and probe everybody's queue.
Okay.
Actually, it doesn't happen in that way, but roughly speaking, that's what happens. And any processor's queue holding this address would actually retry the load and all dependents. Okay, so the load must get the new value. Dependents must re-execute.
Okay.
All right, so this is the reason why you need to hold the address queue entries until retirement. And the reason why you cannot do this search on the active list is because the active list is not a searchable entity. It's not designed to be a searchable. And finally, you free the active list entry itself. So that completes the life of an instruction. Any question? Okay, so all we are left with is the memory hierarchy, which we haven't discussed. So there are on-chip L1 instruction data caches. Both are two-way serosity, 32 kilobyte in size. Data cache has 32 byte line size, while instruction cache has 64 byte line size. Why?
Because of higher spatial locality
in instructions. Right, exactly. Instructions usually have higher spatial locality, and that's because usually execute sequentially. Okay, unless you encounter a branch which takes you somewhere else. So this is the reason why you have a longer cache block size in instructions. Both the caches are virtually indexed and physically tagged, meaning that the cache index is derived from the virtual address, and the tag is derived from the physical address. So this has some implication on how you actually design the cache, this one. So let's try to understand that. So with a 4 kilobyte page size, data cache runs into a synonym problem. So this one we discussed in the class, what a synonym problem is. So just to remind you quickly, imagine that this is my data cache, which is virtually indexed, meaning that if this is a virtual address. So let's try to figure out the parts of the address. So data cache has 32 byte line size, so block offset is 5 bits. How many bits is the index? Is the L1 data cache. So you can verify that. 9 bits. And remaining things are tagged. Okay. So we say that I think it's a 44 bit virtual address. Yeah, 44 bit virtual address. Translates to a 40 bit physical address. So 30 bits. So page size is 4 kilobytes. So my page offset is somewhere here, 12 bits. Okay, so now imagine two virtual addresses, VA1 and VA2. Okay, belonging to two processes, and they want to share these two virtual addresses. Okay. So essentially what it means is that the pages containing these two virtual addresses will actually point to the same physical page in memory, all right? Yeah. Now, so what this means is that, so remember that the translation, when you translate the virtual address to physical address, these 12 bits remain unchanged. They don't change. Because it's offset within a page. So that means if I take VA1 and translate it to the physical address, what will happen is that these 12 bits will remain unchanged, right? And since these two addresses share the same physical page, it's guaranteed that whenever they are referring to the same cache block, same physical cache block, these 12 bits will be identical, right? That's guaranteed. What is not guaranteed is about these two bits. They may or may not be identical. So let's consider the situation when they are not identical. Okay. What will happen is that VA1 will map to some cache index, right? And VA2 will probably map to some other cache index. Alright? So now the first process modifies this particular cache block to VA1, okay, and gets context switched out. The second process reads from this cache block. It's a wrong value. Okay. So essentially the sharing invariant is not broken. So this is called a synonym problem. So essentially these should be synonyms, which was not guaranteed. Is it clear to everybody? So that's the problem is mentioned here. Upper two bits of the index that creates the problem. So that's the first problem that you have to worry about. The second problem is, if you think about the tag, the tag of the cache. So we're saying that it's a physically tagged cache. So each tag of the cache block comes from the physical address. So this virtual address gets translated to the physical address. And essentially what you do is that you take the upper 30 bits of the physical address for the tag, right? So let's see if that can lead to some problem. So imagine two physical addresses, PA1 and PA2. That are the upper 30 bits identical. So these two cache blocks are going to have identical tags, right? Now I'll have a real problem if these 14 bits in the virtual address are identical. Because then what will happen is that the same cache index will have two cache blocks with exactly identical tags. I have no way to distinguish them. They map to the same index. They have the same tags. Okay. Is it clear to you? Okay. So I'm talking about two addresses, two cache blocks that have upper 30 bits identical in the physical address, and the lower 14 bits identical in the virtual address. Okay. That can happen. Okay. So there are two problems. So how do you fix it? So it talks about the solution to the second problem. It says MIPS certainty uses the complete physical page number as a tag. Okay. It uses this part for the tag, 32 bits. Does this solve the problem? Does this solve the second problem? What do you think? If it doesn't, imagine that there are two physical addresses that have identical 32 bits, upper 32 bits in the physical address, and identical lower 12 bits in the virtual address, right? That's what we're essentially saying now, okay? But then they're identical addresses, right? Because translations don't change the lower 12 bits. Right, so this one solves the second problem. If you use the complete physical page number as a tag, wastes only extra 2 bits for tag, not much. So what is the usual solution for avoiding synonyms? Does anybody remember?
Coloring,
yeah. So?
We group all the pages together, which could have, all the synonyms, we could group them together.
All what?
All the synonyms, in this way, I think we ensure that they map to the same block.
Same
block. Same index.
No, can you explain what is the page coloring? What does it do? So you have these 2 bits here in the virtual address, right? So you divide your virtual pages into 4 bits based on these 2 bits, right? And whenever two processes request for 2 virtual pages to be shared, they are picked up from the same column. That guarantees that these 2 bits will be identical. Okay. So that does take care of this problem, okay? But there is an additional issue. That is, so this is our L1 cache, right? And after this, we have an L2 cache. And we say that when you have an inclusive cache hierarchy, if you replace a block from L2 cache, you must inherit the block in the L1 cache, right, to maintain inclusion. And R10K has an inclusive hierarchy. So now imagine a problem. Your L2 cache is physically indexed, physically tagged. So when you replace a block from the L2 cache, you can derive its physical address without any problem from the index of the tag. Okay. So now you send a physical address here to L1 cache asking that invalidate this block. L1 cache has no way of figuring out where this block is from the physical address because it is indexed by the virtual address. But if I give you these two bits of the virtual address, you can actually derive the virtual index because these 12 bits are going to be same in the physical address as the virtual address. You take these two bits and prepare the index of the index in the L1 cache. And then you can invalidate the block. So this is the reason why it maintains these two bits of index in the L2 tag. Okay, so that for inclusion, these invalidations can be performed. When you go to multiprocessors, there will be many other messages that come from the L2 cache to the L1 cache. So remember that in addition to this, you have to do page doubling to solve the semantic problem. This doesn't alone solve it. However, this takes care of designing an inclusive hierarchy where your lowest level cache or the innermost level cache is actually virtual.
Is it clear?
Sir,
so on this, these two bits have to be sent to the
yes. These two bits are communicated to the. Okay, so data cache has four ports. What are these four ports? One is used by refills. One is used by the issued address. One is used by the load retry. And the one is used by store graduation. So remember that when a store commits, it will write to the cache. You require a port. The retry unit has a dedicated port. And these are the traditional addresses that come to the cache
okay.
from the address generation unit. So okay, I have erased that. And refills are coming from the next level of the hierarchy. It reads the data RAM from both the ways speculatively. So what it does is, as we're talking about the L1 cache, it has two ways, right, as it says there. So it actually reads the data from both the ways,
okay,
in parallel, and selects 1 or 0 based on the tag RAM outcome.
Okay.
What was the other option? The other option would be that you first do the tag RAM lookup, compare, figure out if we actually have a hit, and then look up the data RAM based on the hit or miss.
Okay.
So you save time by doing this in parallel. So you look up the data RAM and the tag RAM in parallel, both come out together, you do the hit check on the tag RAM, and then figure out whether to pick one or not to pick anything from the two outcomes of data RAM. So you save time, what do you sacrifice? Yeah?
Power.
You consume more power, exactly. I definitely, so that the power consumption will be actually more than double,
okay,
right? Because in many cases, I wouldn't have access any of the data RAM ways.
Okay.
And even on a hit, I will be accessing only one.
Okay.
Here, in all cases, I'll be accessing two. So this is often called parallel tag data lookup. And are traditionally used in L1 caches to save time. So that's the main purpose. And since L1 caches are normally have small associativity, the energy consumption is still within limit. Right? But you're really targeting a low power design, then probably you wouldn't be doing this. You'd be sacrificing in terms of latency, but you'd be saving in terms of energy.
Okay, I think. Okay, this was the last slide, which I'll cover next time. Or, okay, maybe. Yeah, I'll probably defer it, because.
Okay, all right, let's try. Let me see if I can finish it up. So it's a two-way pseudo set-sensitive cache, configurable at boot time, 512 KB to 16 MB. So what is two-way pseudo set-sensitive? Does anybody remember? No, sorry, second, you look up one of the ways first.
And
yes.
If it hits, then it's fine. If it misses, they look up the second way. If
yeah.
It hits in the second way, then it's up.
Right, exactly. So there are, so you serialize the lookups to the two ways, right? And so there is a fast hit and a slow hit.
Okay.
So why was it done? Normally, why is it done?
0 say now, sir, please.
Yes.
Sorry?
We speculated that only one of the ways will be more used, so why not pick, why not put the more used data into that way? So
right.
You don't have to look up all the ways.
Yeah, so what do you gain?
Time.
Time, exactly. So the fast hit latency is same as a direct map capture is, right? So that's what you say. MIPS Authenticate did not do single serially because of that reason. Can you guess why? It has an off-chip L2 cache. That is a hint. So imagine what you have to do if you had to look up both the tags compared to looking up one tag at a time. What do you gain, what do you lose?
So Authenticate has single serially.
Yes, but they did not have single serially for the reason of having direct map cache latency on fast hits. There is a separate reason for it. Why they did not have a two-way serial cache, as opposed to having a two-way pseudo serial cache. They do gain latency if it hits in the first way, but that was not the primary reason. There's a different compelling reason, and that has to do with the off-chip part of the IP. So your main processor doesn't have the L2 cache inside it. It's outside the, so there is a separate package which has the L2 cache. So you read the tag, bring it here.
Yeah. I think the more bandwidth will be required to do bring R2 tags in parallel.
Yes.
Then in this way, it's a serial.
Right, okay.
So what if we are succeeding more short times, so yeah. they're bringing less data every time.
Yeah, so why is that important? 32 bit stack, right? Sorry, this is L2 cache, so it will be different anyway. So, yeah. No, sorry, second. It saves what?
Bandwidth.
Why is that important?
Yeah.
More wires, right? More wires outside the chip, on the board. Why is that a big deal? Think about the reason why we multiplex RAS and CAS in memory. What was the reason? Okay, so this is the pin limitation. That was the main reason. You need pins to get the data, right? Okay. Because this is off chip. So you need more pins on the chip to get two tags in parallel. That was the same reason why we multiplex the RAS and CAS addresses, because the DRAM is normally pin limited. Okay. Exactly same reason here. It's just a limitation of pins. Authenticate says that we cannot accommodate so many pins to have two tags in parallel. Okay. We have to do so here. Alright? So there is an MRU way selection RAM that's maintained on chip. So it's kind of a predictor, you can say. What it maintains is that for each L2 cache set, it says which way is the MRU way. And they predict that this is the way where you are likely to hit this time, okay, because it was the MRU way last time. So in the first cycle, the 16 data bytes of selected way is read in parallel with the tag. Okay. In the next cycle, next 16 data bytes of the selected way is read in parallel with the tag of the alternate way. Right. Actually, we're toggling one extra address bit. So. Yeah, as the tags arrive on chip, they are compared. Hit on first tag returns critical data in the same cycle. So you have a 32 byte cache line size here. Right? You can see that actually. Because L1 cache is 32 bytes. So whenever L1 cache requests data to the L2 cache, it's always in chunk of 128 data pins here. And however many bits you need for the tag, that's determined by the capacity of the cache.